wanted to start, as you continue to further integrate the Aetna acquisition, analysts are really, I think, excited about the solid execution. What's driving that?
You know, Taylor, we see the challenges in healthcare, and the result of those challenges is the emergence of more consumerism in healthcare. And back in June, at an investor day, we laid out a detailed plan in terms of the near and long-term prospects, what we were going to do, how we were going to do it, and the value that that was going to create. We've had an intense focus on execution, and we're beginning to put the proof points on the board, and people are seeing the results of these two companies coming together as one.
You know, it's interesting. You're an insurer, you're a health services company, you're a pharmacy benefits manager. Given all of those, who at this point is even your biggest competitor?
Well, you know, it's interesting. It's a great question, interesting question. And look, I think in the land of healthcare, you've got multiple competitors. You've got a lot of startups. You've got the established, organizations. And, our strategy is really to put the consumer, at the nucleus of our strategy in an effort to make healthcare local, meet people where they are, whether it's, in the community, in the home, or now in the palm of your hand. What we can do to make healthcare more simple to use and navigate, to be able to get for consumers the information and the resources that they need to make informed decisions. And we think about our North Star as how we can help people achieve their best health. We look today, two-thirds of our country has one or more chronic diseases, and it's those chronic diseases that are accounting for anywhere from 70 to 80% of healthcare costs, but yet we're not achieving our best health outcomes. So we can and we must do better there, and we can be an important part of that solution.
Do you think there's a place in this world for standalone drugstores? Because you've been mentioning the consumer. The consumer might not want that anymore.
Well, obviously, there's a lot of focus on bricks and mortar these days, and we believe that there is a place for the physical bricks and mortar store. But how do you evolve to meet the needs of today's consumer? And that's what we're doing with what we're calling our health hubs. It's the evolution of the drugstore from, a store that is, I'll say, more of a convenience store to one that is more of a health destination. We started in the Houston market this time last year, and the response that we've gotten from our consumers, our customers, has been terrific. We ended 2019 with more than 50 health hubs across, four markets, and we have plans to have more than 600 by the end of this year, 1,500 by the end of 2021. So we're pretty excited about what we're seeing there.
You talk about the consumer, the health hubs, and I wonder if that's what's getting people into the stores, because if I'm a consumer and I get my prescriptions by mail, there's not a clear reason for me to go into the physical retail space, as you just mentioned. What's driving that footprint, that traffic, into an actual store these days?
Well, Taylor, what we're seeing in the health hubs, we are seeing increased utilization of the stores. We're seeing a higher utilization of the health-related services that we're offering, whether it's the services offered through MinuteClinic, additional services, offered through our pharmacies. And we're also looking to innovate. How do we make sure we don't leave any white space for disruption? Mm-hmm. And we've introduced programs that, an example of one, we call a Care Pass. It's more of a subscription service we tested in three markets, and we rolled it out in the fall. And today, we have more than 1 million members that are enrolled, and they, too, are using our stores more frequently, and their basket size is higher as a result.
I've been speaking to a lot of CEOs during the healthcare conference, a lot of the CEOs at big pharmaceuticals, and the clear topic, of course, continues to be drug pricing transparency. What role do you play in continuing to be transparent about drug prices?
Well, Taylor, we think a lot about what we can do to make transparency actionable. And as you think about how that relates to drug pricing, it really starts at the prescription pad. When that physician's getting ready to write that prescription, the physician really, historically, hasn't had any visibility to the patient's out-of-pocket cost. And what we've been doing is working to embed the benefit design into the patient's electronic health record so that the physician can see their out-of-pocket costs, and they can also see up to 5 therapeutic alternatives and the out-of-pocket cost associated with each. What we're seeing is physicians, having that visibility, switch to a lower cost therapy, and the average savings is about $90 a prescription. So we think it's a great example of, how to make transparency actionable.
Out-of-pocket expenses that keep rising for consumers. What role do you play in that?
Well, a lot of it is tied to, what we were just talking about in terms of what we can do to ensure that, right drug, right patient, lowest possible cost. And, you know, whether it's being able to get the patient on a lower cost generic medication, or perhaps, you know, a branded medication that may have a lower cost because of its, you know, formulary position in their benefit design. And that's a role that our PBM plays. And, you know, I'm very proud of the work that our pharmacists do every day in that regard as well.
We talk about drug pricing transparency, Medicare for all potential. What do you see as your biggest regulatory risk this year?
Well, Taylor, I don't know that I would describe this as a regulatory risk, but, you know, in the political, you know, lens, we hear a lot about access, and we certainly believe that, you know, all Americans should have access to affordable care. I don't believe we have enough focus on outcomes. And as we look at the costs associated with healthcare, as we were talking earlier, there's so much more that we can do, you know, that will help bend that cost curve, whether it's, you know, ensuring that care is performed in the right setting with cost as a variable. And, you know, I think we have an opportunity to, you know, bring more focus to that that will bend that cost curve trend.
When Amazon comes into any new industry, the existing players get nervous. Was Amazon's entrance into healthcare the bark more than the bite so far?
Well, you know, Taylor, look, I think, you know, competition, good competition makes all competition better. And, you know, as we were talking earlier, we think a lot about how do we make sure we don't leave any white space for disruption, you know, by, you know, any other form of competition. And that's led to a lot of innovation in our company. The CarePass program, you know, we have a program for, you know, for prescription, high utilizing prescription users called Simple Dose. It's, you know, multi-dose packaging. So, you know, innovation has become an important part of our DNA.
Finally, you took on a lot of debt with the Aetna acquisition. How do you feel about the state of your balance sheet and repaying back some of that debt?
You know, Taylor, we've got a great plan to delever, get our adjusted debt to EBITDA ratio to the low 3x in 2022. Since we closed the transaction, we've repaid $8 billion of debt. And, you know, in 2019, as you look at cash from operations, we'll generate $10.5 billion. So, you know, we have a plan to repay that debt while continuing to invest, you know, back into our stores. We'll invest about, you know, $2.3 to $2.6 billion across the enterprise, you know, as well as maintaining our dividend at $2 a share. So very pleased with the progress being made there.